Hello, everybody. I'm Dr. Amrish Mittal, and I'm today going to be talking a little bit about the future of telemedicine in India and what challenges we have faced. We all have been talking about telemedicine for a long time, but the COVID pandemic, as has already been explained to you by previous speakers, has really sort of exposed us to this and forced us in a way to adopt technologies in a much larger way so that we can connect with our patients and deliver high quality care. Of course, telemedicine is more than that. It is not just direct delivery of patient care. There are many nuances and many aspects to telemedicine, which we'll briefly discuss today. We are talking of telemedicine, and you know very well as healing at a distance. But the important thing is that the fundamental purpose of telemedicine is delivery of healthcare services where patients and providers are separated by distance. Now, sitting here in Delhi and practicing for so many years, before that, a professor in Lucknow, we get patients from thousands of miles away, not hundreds, thousands of miles away. So there is a huge need, there is a huge gap between patients and doctors, healthcare providers in India. The doctors patients want to reach, they are not able to reach easily, and it's a full trek, costing a lot of money and wasting a lot of time. So the idea of telemedicine is that in a country like India, where distances are huge and resources are concentrated in certain areas, fortunately or unfortunately, it is very important to have a method by which people can connect with their healthcare provider. This is the very basis of telemedicine. Of course, as I said, there are little aspects that I will cover. This is actually the whole concept in India has gained ground by the success of mobile phones in India. It is said we have more mobile phones than toilets, actually. But I think now that may have changed with all the programs for toilet building. But the truth is that mobile phones have invaded all homes in India. And within that, smartphones have also invaded. So the issue is that there is access to technology. It has reached every or most homes in India. It is being used much more than people ever thought it would be. And that gives us a unique tool to connect with people and help them connect with their doctors for better medical care. So, of course, we know this. I'm not going to talk about this. Rural versus urban differences, specialist access, distribution of doctors being completely inequitable. You can see that in the COVID pandemic, where all patients or many patients have to rush to larger cities for better care. Of course, access to specialists. And I need not talk about doctor-patient ratio, which is obviously much below global standards in our country. Now, we also know the benefits. We know the access. The first thing is access to your doctor or access to a specialist or a second opinion without moving from your home, right? Obviously, your travel expenses are reduced. It saves you time and bother. You can share records and reports in advance or real time, whatever. And definitely, it reduces risk of infection transmission, which has become the main reason why during this pandemic, we've really adopted telemedicine. The fact that if you come into crowded OPDs or crowded hospitals, you increase your risk of infection. It is very important for us to keep those factors in mind. The pandemic is not going to go away. Other infections are always around. So if you really want to avoid that overcrowding and movement, which is avoidable, then a substantial proportion of patients can benefit simply by connecting through telemedicine facilities, especially in my field of chronic care. I talk of chronic care, it is an ongoing process. It's a patient keeps coming back to you with one thing or the other, with a thyroid value, with the diabetes, HbA1c value. And many times, and it is true, we teach this, many times a specialty like endocrinology is about treating numbers. Not always, there is a big role of physical examination, but there are many patients, especially on follow-up, where we are treating numbers. And why for those numbers do we need to always see the patient? And therefore, if we can avoid that, we are automatically reducing the risk of infection transmission also. Now, there are many types of telemedicine, and most of them I have used, so I will share, put in my personal vignettes here. One is real-time telemedicine, which means A good example of that is a real-time video consultation, which most of us are doing these days, which means you book an appointment with a doctor, you send in a request, you complete the formalities, and then at an appointed time, the doctor and patient are on video with each other, whatever platform you use, but they're on video with each other. Now, since the advent of this pandemic, since March, so we started using this reluctantly in April, and by now I personally have done about 2,000 video consults. I was checking yesterday, it is 1,900 something video consults that I have done during this period, in addition to going to the hospital and seeing patients. So we have learned some things about the actual experience and ground reality. This is the real-time video consulting. The asynchronous means that you sent in a request or a query, and the doctor, when he has time, responds to it typically by email, on email, or sometimes he may call you back. But by and large, it means that it is not a fixed appointment. You're sending in a query with your records and your notes, and the doctor is seeing it whenever he or she has time, makes his notes, and then sends them back to you. There is the issue of remote monitoring. So as far as asynchronous telemedicine goes, consultation goes, that we have been doing for many, many years. Email e-consults have been a common thing in my practice for many years, and they partially work. They work for minor queries. I can't say they really work for very complicated cases, but they do work for minor queries. Again, it's a TSH value or a small number or some side effect that you want to share. It's a good way. Then is the concept of remote monitoring. And, you know, it is amazing with newer technology that you can, sitting at home, see patient's ECG. You can see their glucose recording. You can see the glucose curve. You know, not just one point, but you can see their full tracing of glucose or blood pressure sitting at home. So remote monitoring for those who really need it. And in this day and age when hospital beds in major hospitals can be a real problem, because of COVID and other things, non-COVID patients can avail remote monitoring facilities to great benefit. And I think that's really important. That has enhanced the quality of care we can provide, and also involves patient in self-care. And that really helps in chronic care, because if you cannot, it's not like treating typhoid where you go and get a prescription and then 1 week, 10 days, you're fine. It's like lifelong care. Patient empowerment is a critical part of chronic care and lifelong care. So if you want to deliver that, we need to be experts at remote monitoring. And the technology is quite remarkable, with non-invasive remote monitoring now becoming the order of the day. Even in glucose, we talk of time spent in range. We don't talk of fasting PP. We see 24-hour records and say, well, this person has spent 80% of the time glucose. This person has spent 80% of the time in range, which means the glucose values have been in range 80% of the time. Another aspect of telemedicine that we have also been using is health professional to health professional. This is like someone treating, let's say, an internist, a very good internist in a smaller town, treating a patient with a complex specialty problem, endocrine problem, cardiac problem, and he needs the help and support of a specialist in that field. Then there is a way to connect through telemedicine. So it's a doctor-to-doctor telemedicine, which actually is very popular, especially in the West, for second opinion areas. And even now, if you want to consult someone in larger institutes in the US, you may have to resort to this technology at times. And then, of course, there is a direct-to-patient, which we just talked about, but where you're really giving some simple advice directly to the patient. There are challenges. I have faced challenges, you know, lack of physical examination. And again, pardon me if it sound narrow, but since diabetes is a prototype sort of disease that should be handled by telemedicine, lack of physical examination, foot examination is an important part of diabetes. Eye examination is mandatory. You can postpone it. We have been postponing all eye exams, but till when? But we also know with newer technologies, you can probably just go to an eye center without going too close, just go into a machine, get your fundus clicked, and it'll be analyzed by artificial intelligence and back to the treating doctor. So there are lots of things that can overcome all these things. Even for a foot, maybe you have those mats available and the patient can go and walk on the mat without any major human presence, and that tracing can come, the foot pressure tracing can come to you sitting in your office. So these are so there is a lack of physical examination, and nothing can substitute from third year of medicine. You are taught the most important thing is history and physical examination. And one component of that is to a large extent removed in telemedicine. You can only do the history part really well. You have to resort to other ways for physical examination. Delay in initiating complex therapies. Complex therapy initiation on telemedicine is a challenge, especially self-injectable therapies. For us, insulin is very important. Initiating insulin via telemedicine, although it's you have to do it, you have to suggest to the patient to go to a neighboring physician. We send them videos, we send them recordings, we do, my educators do video discussion with the patient demonstrating the whole thing live, all those, but still it's a challenge. And of course, I think when we are doctors, we really are treating humans, and we are humans too. It's not cut and dried, it's not like a mechanical process. Lack of personal connect and empathy is definitely going to be a problem. Difficulty in building trust. If you're seeing a doctor for the first time and all the time only through telemedicine, then that same feeling cannot be there. When you meet a doctor, talk to him, he may talk a little bit about your family, he may talk about your problems, you may share something with him, he may hold your hand to help you feel better, keep an arm around your shoulder to reassure you. This, those things are important. We have been taught the importance of touch. If you're taking a bedside round and you're not holding the patient's hand, it's not a good bedside round. So really, those things are facing a real challenge during this period. We are having to explain those things in different ways, but it's not the same thing. So there will definitely be a lack of personal connect, a lack of empathy, and some difficulty in building trust. If it's your old follow-up patient and you're following up, then it's different. They already trust you. But if you meet a new patient for the first time on video and continue to follow them on video, I suspect that it'll not be the same. Although, let me say, in the last few months, there are many patients who have only seen on video for the first time until now, who are doing incredibly well and are very grateful. And and there is a connect, but it is not, everyone keeps saying, okay, doctor, let this be over, then we'll come and chat with you, come and meet you. It's not the same thing, but nevertheless, I think we have to talk in a different way, maybe sometimes with completely focused attention, and help the patient gain our confidence. There are technical issues that I am facing. There are systemic issues. Whatever you might say, our networks don't work everywhere. They don't. They work in my house sometimes, in some areas they don't work. So there is a challenge that you may have technical issues. That app or whatever you're using may not be easily downloadable by the patient. Then there are individual challenges and technical issues. So many of my patients are older. I'm not very young myself, but nevertheless, many of the patients who in that age group, they cannot use technology very well. They're not friendly. It's not their fault. They don't have to. It wasn't a requirement for them. And therefore, I am struggling with patients who don't use technology well, who have hearing issues, older patients. So you have to build a triad. So the son is calling from Pune. The father is in, say, Lucknow, and the doctor is here, and there's a three-way call. The reports are not available with the father. The medicines are not clearly. So it is a challenge. There is a technique. He is used to coming to you with all his papers once in 6 months, all his medicines, putting them on your table. You resolve his issues and send him back. Now, suddenly that has become a challenge. So systemic technical challenges and individual technical challenges are both serious issues. And anybody who says there's nothing more we can do, we have to be real. And these challenges will not be overcome easily, but systemic challenges, I suspect, will be overcome. I expect will be overcome. Individual challenges, we'll have to find better and better ways to help people. There is a coordination issue. If you're delayed by 5-10 minutes in your appointment, then, managing the time, the other person is locked in, what should you do? In outpatients, people are used to waiting. In outpatient clinics, they know that they'll have to wait 15-20 minutes, sometimes more. when it's a fixed time call, then they get very anxious. In 5 minutes, maybe the doctor has forgotten. I don't know if I'm getting a call. You're sitting against a wall in darkness. In the clinic, you're seeing doctor is busy. There's a patient going in, coming out. You know, my turn will come. So that coordination is also important. And a very important issue is data sharing. Now, we just started doing this. What about the privacy of data? Do our platforms guarantee that? What about security? Tomorrow, there can be a whole new story about, you know, your data getting hacked or something and all medical records being. So you need to be very careful in the long run if you're going to use this technology, which I am for sure. We need to be very careful about data sharing, privacy, security. These are very important things. Data sharing is very helpful, but the privacy and security has to be maintained. If I see a patient and I'm referring to somebody else, that person should be able to see the data without the security being compromised. Right? So I think that's going to be a critical thing in the long run. And I know a lot of technical research is going on in this area, and we do expect that there will be good outcomes, but that is a challenge. And last, of course, are legal issues. What about legal issues? I mean, the government has come out with rules. They have come out with guidelines, not specific rules. They are guidelines. They are guidelines from the medical council. Everyone issued guidelines. They should suggest how to help. But we don't know the legality of some of these things. And we don't want, right now it's a COVID pandemic, but tomorrow there will be dissatisfaction, errors. And you don't want that. You're, on the one hand, you're using telemedicine to help your patients. You don't want to get caught on the wrong foot. If you're trying to help, there was some error in understanding about dose, about administration, and the patient lands up in a crisis. You don't want that for your patient. You will hate that. Plus, you don't want that for yourself. You're exposing yourself. So legal issues do still remain important in this area. And at the very end of this brief talk, I will talk about what is our wish list. We wish to have a platform that integrates various capabilities. We've talked about many capabilities. We want them all integrated. Right now, doing one with this, one with that, piecemeal, is mind-boggling and a real strain for us and compromises quality of care. The capability should start with learning for doctors. The platform should have, I mean, we are doing 100 webinars, you know, but the app itself or the platform itself should have learning for doctors, upgrading knowledge. They should be able to choose the field. It should have information about all the latest technology, latest treatments. In COVID, treatments are changing every day. So the ability to grasp and pick out those treatments should be like a constant stream, authenticated by experts, authenticated by various bodies, approved by the government. Flowcharts for almost all diseases exist with the government. We've made them, helped make them. The ICMR has them, even for things like diabetes, type 2 diabetes, type 1 diabetes. We really need to do that. So learning for doctors is important. We were talking only of patient care, but this is also a part of patient care. Patient education, not customized to all the time to like your problem per se, but overall patient education, knowledge about chronic care, knowledge about diabetes, knowledge about COVID, knowledge about spreading infection, knowledge about hygiene, nutrition. The biggest challenge in India is nutrition. Knowledge about nutrition. You know, this needs to go out in a friendly way, in a sort of entertaining way, right? Rather than being didactic lecturing. So people are experts at that in communication. They can help with that. And this has to be targeted even to the remotest rural area. If you're doing just urban awareness, this whole thing, you know, you have limited range, limited vision. If you're thinking of rural development, you're thinking of your villages, you really have to make sure that it is simplified in the vernacular at some stage. It should be so easy that people who are not very digital friendly can also use it. I am expecting with the launch of the National Digital Health Mission, all these will slowly become the norm, you know, but we really have to make sure that, or try at least, that any platform we use has all these facilities. It should ensure compliance and enhance adherence. Reminders about testing, reminders about appointments, reminders about, you know, food from time to time would be a big help. They can help in transition in care a lot if the platform has the capability. And I think that should not be difficult. When you go from hospital to home, when you leave your home to go and stay with your son or daughter in some other city. That transition in care, that should be completely seamless and facilitated by a platform. Now, all this may not be possible right now, but I'm saying I would love to have a platform like that. So, you know, hospital to home care is a very important thing. There are a lot of practical issues, simple issues. Like if you know, somebody is admitted for, let's say, even COVID is a good example because that's occupying our mind space these days. And the diabetes has gone haywire. The sugars are all over the place. And you need on multiple insulin shots. Patient now has to transit to home. Now he has come from 500 miles away and he's going to go back. And suddenly he reaches there. He's at a loss. Despite being explained, his brain was not receiving or recording your teaching at that point. And in COVID, you don't teach so much face-to-face. So he doesn't know what to do. Does he take his insulin? How does he take it? How does he monitor? Those are the kind of things that a platform can really help with. Of course, we know second opinions, expert opinion is a very important. That is in the West, it's common and we share it across the world. And as I said, data from monitoring devices. Supposing somebody is admitted to the hospital and you're discharging, you put in a monitoring device on that patient for glucose. And you know that next 1 week is critical for this person's glucose control, but he does not need to stay in hospital. And you can get regular signals from that about the fluctuations. You can set alarms to tell you that the sugar has gone to 500 or whatever you or your colleague, your junior doctor, your educator, anybody can do that. But the issue is that there is a possibility to connect. So quite clearly, I made a longish wish list, and it could be longer also, but I thought it'll be too much to put it all here. If one has a platform that is able to incorporate all this, it'll be fantastic. The other thing that I want to say just before I sign off is that, you know, there is a concept of virtual clinic. And I think that will also really help. A concept where patient is not just talking face to face. He actually thinks he's in a clinic. You can create an environment where the patient comes and sits on feels that he's sitting across a table with you. And he's actually in a doctor's waiting area. I think those kind of things will enhance patient experience, improve compliance, allow us to provide better care to our patients, allow us to provide better learning to each other, and definitely improve overall standards of healthcare. I think telemedicine, and as the National Digital Health Mission is coming in, where patients' records are all going to be stored and shared across the system, I think is the future. And in a country like India, it has tremendous scope. And I hope we'll have better and better platforms that will allow us to practice. So many such platforms are now entering the fray, and I've heard about Connect to Clinic, and I'm curious to see what it offers and how it helps my patients and how it helps me to take care of my patients.